Conservative media done right. You're listening to the SHR Media Network.
I'm Jason Miller. Tonight on the Evan Miller Report, Ramadi is taken over the weekend by the likes of Dinesh. What's going to happen in the region? We have the full story tonight. Iran is using maritime confrontations to project power in the Gulf. This, according to a new report by Arab allies who are talking to Washington and accusing Tehran of destabilizing the region. The British Navy is investigating a sailor's claims that a disaster is waiting to happen over its nuclear subs. And in Canada, they are set to retaliate against the U.S. over a new labeling scheme. I'm Jason Miller. You're listening to the Evan Miller Report. Also on this program, Lindsey Graham says he's ready to announce for president, adding his name to the long list of GOP candidates who want to be your next president in 2016. We have all those stories and more. Plus, Corey Evan.
You know, they're just going to trip all over each other. And while John the Failure Kerry slams North Korea, the United Nudists are slamming the Pacific Rim nations to get migrants ashore, wherever. Okay, here's one good thing Jeb Bush has said. Gay marriage isn't a constitutional right in our continuing battle against global socialism. Petrol, how high can you go? In biz, how high can you go? Petrol, how high can you go? Okay, stop. More lawsuits are coming in over last week's deadly Amtrak derailment. And Taylor Swift is giving the Billboard Awards crowd something to talk about. What exactly? You'll find out in this installment of your conservative news source, the Evan Miller Report. Let's start now.
Live from Southern California, this is the Evan Miller Report. Jason Miller with news and politics, Corey Evan with business. This is the Evan Miller Report on SHR Media. Here now, Jason Miller.
And a very good evening on this Monday, May the 18th, 2015. I'm Jason Miller along with Corey Evan this evening. We hope you had a great weekend wherever you might be. Whether the weather was good or whether the weather was bad, we all hope you had a great weekend this weekend. A lot of news.
It's just adding up to a lovely summer.
Yes, absolutely. It's going to be a little cool, and then the heat is going to come right here and hit us here in Southern California before you know it. And then, as the beach goers like to say, especially our surfer friends, the surf's up.
Oh, yeah. So, take the weather while it's still good, folks.
Absolutely right. Go out there, ride some bikes, have some fun. Or if you're just in for a good book like I am, go sit out on your porch with your iPad. And read off your reading app or any of a physical book if you have one, and read a good book. It's good weather to do it. All right, folks, we have a lot to get to tonight, so let's go and get right to it. We start off in Ramadi tonight over in Iraq, where Shia militias are now assembling east of the Iraqi city to prepare for a counterattack offensive against the Dinesh militants who captured it over the weekend. According to Iraqi state TV, it's described tanks and other military vehicles entering Al-Habab military camp. Dinesh fighters are reportedly moving towards the base. The Iraqi government called for help from the Iran-backed militias after the military was routed and fled. About 500 people died in the city only 70 miles west of Baghdad. Shia forces of Hanbana, about 12 miles from Ramadi, were now on standby. The head of the Anbai Provincial Council, Sabir Khara, was quoted by the Reuters and ITN news agencies as saying, in a statement, the council said about 3,000 Shia fighters had arrived in Anbar province to take part in the liberation of all Ramadi areas in which Dinesh militants took positions. But Dinesh militants have also advanced from Ramadi to the outskirts of the town of Al-Kahidi near the Hangbine base, according to a Dinesh statement and witnesses in the region. The fall of Ramadi is a disaster for the Iraqi government and for the Iraqi army and government, and especially its prime minister, Haider al-Abadi. After the recapture of another provincial capital to Crete at the end of March, he announced the start of a similar campaign to liberate Anbar province, the country's biggest, and flew to Ramadi to kick it off. Now Ramadi has gone, and along with its military command center for the whole province, a few days before the final collapse on Sunday, Mr. Abdi said he would not allow it to fall. But it did fall. Stay with the Evan Miller Report for the latest out of the region of Ramadi and how this will affect U.S. Relations with Iraq. We'll keep you up to date with the very latest. Over to Iran now, where it is using its sea power in the Gulf to show it will not be cowed by Washington's newly assertive Arab allies, prompting critics to accuse Tehran of destabilizing the region. Iranian ships have fired shots at a Singapore flag tanker, which it said damaged an Iranian oil platform, causing the vessel to flee, and seized a container ship in the Strait of Hormuz, the world's most important oil route, over a debt row. The instance coincided with a push by Washington to reassure Gulf Arab monarchies that their interests would not be threatened by a nuclear accord that Tehran and world powers are trying to reach by the end of June with the United States. In an escalating confrontation with Saudi Arabia over Yemen, Tehran criticized the Arab states for recklessness and brutality in that country, where a Saudi-led coalition is attacking an Iranian-allied militia. Iran has also sent an aid ship to the Iran Shahid to the Yemeni Red Sea port of Hodeidah to test a naval blockade enforced by the coalition. Several Iranian military officials have warned of war if the Iran Shahid is attacked by Saudi-led forces. It is expected to reach port by Thursday. To the UK now, where Britain's Royal Navy has said today it has lodged an inquiry after a sailor who served on one of its submarines armed with nuclear weapons said the vessels had a major security flaw and were a disaster waiting to happen. In a lengthy doiser released on the internet, able seaman William McKinley, who describes himself as a weapons engineer, said Britain's Trident nuclear defense system was vulnerable both to enemies and to potentially devastating accidents because of safety failures. He said, quote, "Our nuclear weapons are a target that's wide open to attack." He has since gone absent without leave, but he continued to say, "All it takes is someone to bring a bomb on board to commit the worst terrorist attack on the UK and the world has ever seen." End of quote. The Royal Navy said it totally disagreed with McNeely's subjective and substantiated personal views, describing him as a very junior sailor, but it added it was investigating both his claims and the unauthorized releases of his dozer. The Naval Service operates its submarine fleet under the most stringent safety regime, and submarines do not go to sea unless they are completely safe to do so, said a spokeswoman. McNeely said people were not properly checked or searched before being able to get near or on the submarines, and that even nightclubs had stricter security. He said that he knows most people know the Trident program is a disaster waiting to happen, but they never tell the public, he wrote. Police and naval officials were trying to find McNeely. Their Ministry of Defense spokeswoman declined to say whether he faced arrest for breaking the UK's Official Secrets Act. To Ukraine, where they say they will prosecute two men in claims that elite Russian soldiers captured fighting in eastern Ukraine. The two wounded men were seized in the town of Shuista, about 19 miles away from the Russian border. The head of Ukraine's security service has told the BBC that there is proof the men are Russian troops. Russia said the two men were no longer serving as soldiers. Rebels in eastern Ukraine said the men were policemen from Ukraine's Luhansk region. Vilda Nede, Ukraine's security chief, told BBC World News he was absolutely positive the men were officers from the GRU, the Foreign Military Intelligence Branch of Russia's army. He continued to say, quote, "We have battle dress uniform. We have automatic rifles that are produced only in the Russian Federation, only for special forces use." Mr. Nadyad said there were men part of a group of 220 GRU officers deployed to Lunatesk on May the 2nd. The others have now returned to Russia, he said. He also said that they have started a criminal case for a terrorist act in the country in regards to this case. In a video, one of the captured men said he was a sergeant from the central Russian city of Togolde, where an elite intelligence unit for a Russian army is based. The video has not yet been independently verified. Canada is to pursue regulatory trade measures against the U.S. over what it says are discriminatory labeling practices, following a win Monday before the World Trade Organization. The dispute centers on a U.S. regulation in place since 2009, which requires that certain product labels must include an item's country of origin. Canada, which said the measure adversely affects its pig and cattle breeders, successfully challenged the regulation before the World Health Organization. Excuse me, the World Trade Organization was not the World Health Organization, it is the World Trade Organization. My apologies for the spell error. America's largest trade partner had previously fought the so-called cool country of origin labeling rule at the WTO, saying it discriminated against Canadian products and won, but Washington tweaked the regulation to circumvent the ruling. Monday's appeal victory in the quarrel, which pitted Canada and Mexico against the U.S., marked a final decision without the possibility of further appeal, said Ed Fast, Canada's Minister of International Trade. The WTO reaffirmed Canada's long-standing position that these measures are blatantly protectionist and discriminate against Canada, Fast added. In a light of the final ruling, and due to the fact that the U.S. has continue to discriminate against Canadian livestock products, Canada will be seeking authority from the WTO to use retaliatory measures on U.S. horticulture and non-horticulture projects. And Corey Evan will be with us later to tell us how this affected the U.S. markets today, coming back from the weekend, and he'll have a full report there. Meantime, I will send it over to Corey Evan. He has some other international news stories to report on tonight.
Thank you very much, Jay. And we start in South Korea, where U.S. Secretary of State John the Failure Kerry today accused North Korea of a litany of crimes and atrocities while reassuring South Korea of America's ironclad security commitments. Define ironclad, you failure. Anyway, according to Politico, Kerry blamed North Korea for continuing to break promises, make threats, and show flagrant disregard for international law by continuing to build its nuclear bomb and missile programs, even as it oppressed its own people. He said North Korea's horrific conduct must be exposed, and he vowed to ratchet up pressure on Pyongyang to change its behavior, particularly since it's rebuffed repeated attempts to restart nuclear disarmament negotiations. His comments come less than a week after South Korea's spy agency said North Korean leader Kim Jong-un ordered his defense chief executed with an anti-aircraft gun for complaining about the young ruler talking back to him and sleeping during a meeting Kim presided over. That allegation, if true, adds to worries about the erratic nature of Kim's rule, particularly after Pyongyang claimed last weekend it had successfully test-fired a newly developed ballistic missile from a submarine. Kerry called the reported killing just the latest in a series of grotesque, grisly, horrendous public displays of executions on a whim and fancy. He said that if such behavior continued, calls would grow from the international community for North Korea to be referred to the International Criminal Court. South Korean Foreign Minister Yun Byung-se said, quote, "The severity of recent threats and provocations," unquote, "make it essential to bolster the security relationship of the longtime allies." The actions come despite a recent U.S. diplomatic overture to North Korea to discuss resuming nuclear disarmament talks that have been stalled for years. The U.N. has condemned the refusal of Southeast Asian countries to rescue thousands of migrants adrift at sea, according to the BBC. At least 700 Bangladeshis and Rohingya from Myanmar were rescued off Aceh last week by locals, bringing the numbers in camps there to at least 1,500. UNHCR spokeswoman Vivian Tan said the lack of rescues over the weekend was a bad sign. Aid agencies said a humanitarian crisis is in train as countries in the region refuse to accept the migrants. People on the boats are believed to be severely malnourished. Survivors who have made it to shore say there have been deadly fights on board over food. The Indonesian authorities have told fishermen not to help the migrants unless their boats are sinking or they are in the water. Military spokesperson Fuad Basia said fishermen could deliver food, fuel, and water to the boats or help with repairs, but that bringing them to shore would constitute an illegal entry into Indonesia. Some fishermen in Indonesia's Aceh province had told the BBC that they were not allowed to help migrants, even if they were drowning. Thousands of people, mostly Rohingya Muslims fleeing persecution and poverty in Myanmar, but also Bangladeshis looking for work, are thought to be stranded out at sea. And I'll keep an eye on that situation, and I'll let you know what comes of it, whether in our next report or on the Facebook page. The FBI has ruled out a gun as being the cause of windshield damage on an Amtrak train that derailed while rounding a curve last week, this from the LA Times. But federal investigators said today they have not ruled out the possibility that something else struck the engineer's cab. The question facing investigators looking into Tuesday's crash in Philly is whether a projectile could have distracted the train's engineer and led the train to barrel into the curve zone for 50 miles an hour at more than 100. The latest developments in the investigation came as the railroad resumed full service on its busy Northeast Corridor, linking Washington, D.C. to Boston. Also Monday, funerals were held in New York, New Jersey, and Michigan for three of the eight passengers killed when Amtrak's 188 train flew off the track as it headed toward New York City. In a brief update posted on Twitter, the NTSB said that the FBI, quote, found no evidence of damage to Amtrak's windshield by a firearm, and they have not ruled out possibility that another object may have struck the locomotive windshield. That's at least according to their latest tweet. The first train to pass north through Philadelphia since the crash arrived at New York's Penn Station shortly before 8 a.m. It was about 35 minutes late, typical of Amtrak, but none of the passengers were complaining, thankfully. An Amtrak spokeswoman, Kimberly Woods, say there were about 50 passengers on that train. Normally, there would be more than 200 on one of Amtrak's Washington to New York trains, but the railroad full resumption of service only on Sunday night, so many potential riders would that service resumed. Passengers said the train moved slowly through Philadelphia, especially as it rounded the curve where Tuesday night's derailment occurred. An Amtrak official cited an abundance of caution for the slowdown there. Patrick Isak Ponwu, a regular rider on the route, said he was not nervous about Monday's ride, saying that he's lived there so long, and when he sees things like this accident, it doesn't worry him. He knows that things happen, and that's a good attitude to go on board with. The possibility that a rock or other projectile hit the Amtrak Northeast Regional Train 188 moments before it derailed is one of many that safety officials are exploring as they seek a cause for the deadly accident, according to a top federal official Sunday. The FBI was at the accident scene Monday to examine the wreckage and try to determine what may have hit the train, said Robert Sumwalt, a member of the NTSB. So far, officials have interviewed dispatchers and listened to dispatch tapes and have heard no communication at all from the Amtrak engineer to the dispatch center to say that something had struck his train. That, according to Sumwalt, as he made the rounds of Sunday morning news programs, nor did the engineer of a nearby commuter train that was struck recall any conversation between the crew of his train and Amtrak 188, he added. Speaking of the Sunday morning media broadcasts, did you happen to see any of those broadcasts, Jay?
No, I did not, Corey. I took one of those very few weekends and decided to take the weekend off and add a 24-hour period where I had no news whatsoever. I just watched a five-minute news brief from ITN, and that was it. I just decided...
You've had enough of George Snuffleupagus, haven't you?
Yes, I have. Certainly have. I don't watch those Sunday morning tabloid news programs. That's what I call them these days.
Yeah, whether it's George Snuffleupagus or Meet the Liars.
Ooh, yeah. We can't forget that.
Yeah, because...
Because
I don't currently have access, but
either.
Yes, Face the News as well. Yeah, right now I'm getting TV service in the works at my studio. Right now I get updates on my phone. That's why I asked you, because I know normally you keep an eye on these things, but knowing them, they would have analyzed this to death, basically.
So always do on the Sunday morning programs. That's why it's always full of junk, and we look for the real news here on the Evan Miller Report.
Yeah, Brandon, we don't give you live witness news.
Oh, absolutely right. All right, folks, we're going to go ahead and take our first ad break here on the program. But when we come back this evening, one former vice presidential candidate's daughter has to cancel her wedding because of the tabloids. We got that in the political news tonight. Also, did a hacker take control of a U.S. flight from his own seat on the plane? We'll tell you how and why. President Obama is going to restrict military gear from going to police. This after an announcement in a speech he made today. Is it worth your time? We'll tell you. And facing a $1 billion deficit, one state decides to sharply limit welfare. Plus, Corey Evan asks what's coming up in the business news.
Yeah, gun control's back in the media again. Right, back to petrol. We'll find out exactly how much it's going to cost to fill up, at least several examples of it, as we go into that all-important Memorial Day weekend. In addition to lawsuits coming in over last week's Amtrak derailment in the state of Pennsylvania, we will also have one lawsuit coming out of Washington State over a little girl who had a little trouble with a classmate. And Taylor Swift is giving the Billboard Awards crowd something to talk about, particularly with a smooch. To whom? You'll find out in our entertainment report. That all is coming up in this edition of the Evan Miller Report after the break. You're listening to SHR Media.
Conservative media done right. You're listening to the SHR Media Network.
How you doing? John Grant here. When I'm not slaving over a hot microphone on the 405radio.com Saturdays at 10 a.m. Eastern, I check out Sean and Clint here at Sackheads Radio. We all appreciate the best political bloggers, writers, and commentators. We either get them on our shows or we make fun of them, as it should be. So check us out live Saturdays at 10 a.m. Eastern or forever on the podcasts on the 405radio.com.
This is Tammy Jackson inviting you to join me on the Tammy Jackson Show every Tuesday night at 7 p.m. Pacific on the 405radio.com. Put down that remote and tune into the show that covers politics, guns and the Second Amendment, religious liberty, sanctity of life, the military, and more. I host newsworthy guests and work hard to be a conservative radio show that's not like all the others. So save Tuesday nights at 7 p.m. Pacific for me, Tammy Jackson, on the 405media.com.
Hello, I'm Paul, a student at Hillsdale College. Here is my professor, Dr. Larry Arn, on the separation of church and state.
America's founders believed in the separation of church and state, in that the country was not to have an official religion or an official sect. But that did not mean that government was to be hostile to religion, or even indifferent to religion, as many today argue. In fact, America's founding document, the Declaration of Independence, includes both a reference to God as the author of the laws of nature and a confident assertion that human beings are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights. Far from being hostile or indifferent to religion, America's founders understood the theology of the Declaration to be an essential part of the education of citizens.
This Constitution Minute was brought to you by Hillsdale College. To join the national conversation on the Constitution, go to constitutionminute.org.
Hi, this is Rooster from Outcry Radio. Catch me here on Blog Talk Radio every Saturday night at 11 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, or follow my blog. Now, back to the Sackheads.
Conservative media done right. You're listening to the SHR Media Network.
St. Jude is leading the way childhood cancer is treated and defeated in communities across America. and no family receives a bill from St. Jude, not for treatment, travel, housing, or food.
So parents at St. Jude can focus on what matters most, helping their child live.
Give thanks.
Give thanks.
Give thanks for the healthy kids in your life and give to those who are not. Go to stjude.org or shop wherever you see the St. Jude logo.
There's the closing bell. I'm Corey Evan with your business report on the Evan Miller Report. Jason will be back in just a few short moments. In the meantime, the Dow is up 26 points at 18,298. The Nasdaq's up 30 points at 5078, and the S&P 500 is up 6 points at 2129. So the Dow, compared to the others, isn't exactly keeping pace in my analysis. Anyway, European shares closed higher on Monday after trading in and out of the red during the trading session amid growing concerns about the future of cash-strapped Greece. Greek stocks reversed direction to close 1.6% higher, helping guide the Eurostoxx 600 index to a positive close. The pan-European index ended around 0.4% higher. The UK's benchmark FTSE ended provisionally 0.1% higher, trumped by the French CAC, which closed unofficially 0.3%. The real performer was the German DAX, which closed provisionally 1.3% higher, boosted by a rally in shares of Volkswagen, of course. Its stock closed over 3% higher after a target price upgrade by Deutsche Bank, according to Reuters. One of the nation's largest women apparel companies have added two major brands to its lineup. Ascena Retail Group, the parent of Lane Bryant and Dress Barn, announced today that it will acquire the company that owns Ann Taylor and Loft in a deal valued at about $2 billion. Combined, the companies will have short of 5,000 stores worldwide and expect to generate $7.3 billion in sales. There had been chatter on Wall Street for months that Ann was considering a sale. Back in August, activist investor Engine Capital, I think that's how you say it, and hedge fund Red Alder urged Ann to pursue a buyout. The company saw its profits shrink last year, and sales at its stores open more than a year were down close to 2%. Ann Taylor and Loft, like many other chains, have struggled amid a deeply promotional retailing environment in which customers have come to expect a constant drumbeat of 40% off your purchase offers. Ann Taylor's got 361 stores nationwide, while its sister brand Loft has 664. Their fleet of stores also include Ann Taylor Factory, its destination for deal hunters, and a new active and casual wear concept, Lou & Gray, which has just 5 locations but is thought to have strong growth potential. The chains will join Ascena's portfolio of mall staples such as plus-size retailers Lane Bryant and Catherine's, as well as Dress Barn, Maurice's, and children's clothing store Justice, and of course, her brothers, I believe is the name of the place. In their announcement of the sale, the retailer stressed that their organizations were highly complementary because they are both focused on women's apparel, and yet Ann Taylor and Loft target a slightly different kind of customer than existing Ascena-owned chains. Both companies have similar retail real estate portfolios. And stocks soared 20% in early morning trading. Ascena stock was up about 1%. And AAA says gas prices are on the rise leading up to the busy Memorial Day travel weekend. In its weekly report, AAA says the national average price for a gallon of unleaded was $2.70 compared with $2.66 a week ago. Still, prices are nearly a dollar lower than a year ago, although in California, it is a dollar higher. But back to this, gas prices in the D.C. were...
Gentlemen, the environmentalists are in control in this state. Plus, you have that summer blend coming online, so go figure.
Oh, great. More environmental regulations making me stutter. Anyway, gas prices in D.C. were up 5 cents on Sunday compared to a week earlier. The average price was $2.79 a gallon there Sunday. And in Maryland, the average price on Friday was $2.64 compared with $2.63 a week earlier. Ooh, a whole penny. And a month ago, the average price there was $2.38 in Maryland. So there you are, ladies and gentlemen. Just a snapshot of what you can expect going into Memorial Day weekend. My advice, fill up Friday and be ready for the weekend travel and then enjoy Monday.
All right. Corey Evan with the business news. Thank you very much for that. Corey Evan will be back in a couple minutes with tonight's Lawsuits Across America and the Entertainment Report. A lot of Taylor Swift in the Entertainment Report, just to give you a preview on tonight's Entertainment Report. All right, folks, time for some political news. But first, a story that's sort of political, but sort of entertainment. Let me explain. Bristol Palin and Dakota Meyer are not getting married as expected. Why are you reading this, Mr. Miller, you might ask? Well, it's because Bristol Palin is former vice presidential candidate Sarah Palin's daughter, and her BU, a Medal of Honor recipient, had a Memorial Day weekend wedding planned for May the 23rd, but plans fell through after people here in the tabloids, that's us at the media, report that Dakota had, quote, a secret wife. It happened to be that the former governor of Alaska broke the news for her daughter on Facebook, saying, quote, Bristol and Dakota couldn't be more thankful for the love and support of family and friends over the past months while preparing for their wedding. They have informed loved ones that unfortunately the announced celebration planned for the 23rd of May will not be held, Sarah stated, although there will still be a party for those who already made plans to attend the festivities. Many friends and family still look forward to getting together that day in Kentucky anyway, and the Palins and Myers are happily looking forward to still being at the old Kentucky home on May the 23rd to celebrate life in general, Sarah continued. She continued to say family members and close friends know they are welcome to share a great barbecue on the farm that day. All involved, especially Dakota, Bristol, and Tripp, and their parents and grandparents, thank supporters for the love they expressed. Sarah also further addressed the tabloid reports with words from her daughter, saying, quote, regarding scandalous headlines in recent days about secret wives, Dakota and I discussed our past relationships prior to our engagement. Dakota was legally divorced years ago, as any good reporter could and should have disclosed to readers, Bristol said. As usual, false stories and dramatically written headlines begging controversy should be disregarded, and we have faith that our privacy will be respected at this time by those with decency. Bristol ended her message with a thank you, but speculation still continues as if to the wedding will be rescheduled on Saturday. Bristol posted a picture with her engagement ring, which we will go ahead and post the story with that picture of that ring up on our Facebook page, facebook.com/TheEvanMillerReport. And I'll bring Corey Evan into this. You know, when it comes to the tabloids, you know, the Palins no longer involved in politics. As far as Sarah Palin's concerned, yeah, she does a couple political speeches. She's a Fox News analyst. That's pretty much what all she is. Tabloids should just be minding their own business. But we know tabloids, especially considering we're here in Southern California and live close to old Hollywood there, Corey Evan. Those tabloid people sure haven't learned their lesson from the death of Princess Diana back in the 90s.
Oh, man. Just goes to show you what kind of society we live in. And last time we talked about Bristol Palin in any sort of depth was back when we were in college. Remember when we did that little running gag where we briefly talk about Bristol Palin, then quickly move on to the next story?
Yep, absolutely. And on that note, it's time to move on because we have other...
One of these times, though, I'll track down all that footage and I'll post it up for like a throwback Thursday. How's that?
There you go. Sounds like a plan. All right, Corey. Have you flew a plane lately? If not...
No, I haven't.
Well, you might be thankful because a cybersecurity analyst who was removed from a United Airlines flight after tweeting about the airplane security vulnerabilities has told the FBI that he had previously hacked into an in-flight entertainment system on a different flight and was able to take command of the plane long enough to make it fly sideways. This according to a recently released search warrant filed by the agency. Chris Roberts, founder of the One World Labs organization, was questioned by the FBI on April the 15th. No relation to the sinking of the Titanic in the story, by the way, ladies and gentlemen. Just want to get that cleared out of the way. But this happened on April the 15th upon landing at the airport in Syracuse after his flight from Chicago. According to the search warrant, Roberts told the FBI in February he had taken control of an aircraft, overriding the code on the plane's thrust management computer and issuing a CLB or command to climb command. He stated that he thereby caused one of the airplane's engines to climb, resulting in a lateral or sideways movement of the plane during one of these flights, said FBI Special Agent Mark Hurley, who wrote in the warrant application, which was filed to the U.S. District Court for the Northern District of New York and published by a Canadian media outlet. He also stated that he used Vortex software after compromising, exploiting, or hacking the airplane's networks. He then used the software to monitor traffic from the cockpit system. According to the warrant, Roberts, who for years has warned airplane manufacturers of their vulnerability to hackers, he accessed in-flight networks more than 15 times between the years 2011 and 2014 by connecting a modified internet cable to a box under the passenger seat in front of him, and discovered vulnerabilities in three types of Boeing aircraft as well as the new Airbus A320, but he did not indicate which flight he was able to briefly commandeer. So disturbing. If you're flying in a plane, ladies and gentlemen, be careful. You never know if you're going to have a hacker on board. All right, some light political news today, as there's not a lot going on in D.C. President Obama has banned the U.S. government from giving certain kinds of military-style equipment to local police forces, an announcement which, following criticism that police were too heavily handed in dealing with protests in Ferguson, Missouri, and Missouri that some people say turned violent last summer. It means armored vehicles on tracks, camouflage uniforms, and grenade launchers will no longer be given out. Tensions between police and African-American communities are strained, says the president. He says a series of fatal shootings by police have increased mistrust and sparked protests across the U.S., but the sight of police dressed in camouflage and riot gear dealing with the protests have provoked a stroke of criticism. The audience can be the judge of this story. All right, folks, moving on, we have another person joining that, possibly joining that wide group of GOP candidates for president. Who's that person, you may ask? Well, it's a current senator by the name of Lindsey Graham. The Republican foreign policy hawk, to some, has confirmed that he will run for U.S. president in 2016. The senator from South Carolina told the CBS This Morning program that he would make an official announcement on June the 1st in his hometown of Central. But when asked why he was considering it, he said, quote, "I'm running because the world is falling apart, and he would make the best commander-in-chief. He becomes the seventh leading Republican to join a crowded field." Mr. Graham has been a fierce critic of President Obama's foreign policy, particularly in the Middle East. He also wants U.S. ground troops to be sent into Iraq and Syria to combat the likes of Daesh, to prevent terror attacks in the U.S. And we'll leave the rest of the analysis and the talk of this over to our friend Ken McClinton, the exceptional conservative, who is coming up at the top of the hour at 9 Eastern, 6 Pacific on this station. All right, one more story got here before we send it over to Corey Evan for tonight's lawsuits across America. Facing a $1 billion budget deficit, Arizona's Republican-led legislator has reduced the lifetime limit for welfare recipients to the shortest window in the nation. Low-income families on welfare will now have their benefits cut off after just 12 months. As a result, the Arizona Department of Economic Security will drop at least 1,600 families, including more than 2,700 children, from the state's federally funded welfare program when the new budget year begins in July. The cuts of at least $4 million reflect a prevailing mood among lawmakers in control of Arizona that welfare, Medicaid, and other public assistance programs are crutches that keep the poor from getting back on their feet and achieving their potential. One Republican said, quote, "I tell my kids all the time that the decisions we make have rewards or consequences, and if I don't ever let them face those consequences, they can't get back on the path to rewards," said Republican Senator Kel Ward during debate on the budget. "As a society, we are encouraging people at times to make poor decisions, and then we reward them. Cutting off these benefits after just 1 year isn't fair," said Jessica Lopez, 23, who gave birth to her son while living in a domestic violence shelter and struggled to hold on to jobs because she has dyslexia and didn't finish high school. Well, whose fault is that? I believe it's hers, ladies and gentlemen. I'm just saying. But back to the story. Most states impose a 5-year limit on welfare benefits, 13 states limited to 2 years or less, and Texas has a tired time limit that can be as little as 12 months long, but allows children to continue to receive funding even after the parents have been cut from the system, said welfare policy analyst Liz Schatz. Long-term welfare recipients are often the most vulnerable, suffering from mental and physical disabilities, poor jobs, histories, and little education, she said, but without welfare, they're likely to show up in other ways that will cost taxpayers, from emergency rooms to shelters to the criminal justice system, she said. Arizona's legislature has cut the budgets on an array of problems to meet the governor's no tax increase pledge. The bill that includes welfare cuts received overwhelming support earlier this spring from Republicans, with just one Democrat voting in favor. All right, and I'm just getting the little voice in my ear here that Corey Evans says he does have some stories for our continuing battle against global socialism tonight. Corey, take it away.
Well, I've got one big one that I need to bring you, and it involves none other than Jeb Bush. He knows the way he would rule on same-sex marriage if he were Supreme Court Justice. This is from KansasCity.com. Interviewed Sunday by the Christian Broadcasting Network's David Brody, Bush was asked whether he believed that gay marriage was a right protected by the U.S. Constitution. He said, quote, "I don't, but I'm not a lawyer, and clearly this has been accelerated at a warp pace. The Supreme Court is expected to rule sometime next month on whether gay marriage should be made legal in all 50 states, and Bush tied the future of the country itself to the issue of the family structure. Quote, "To imagine how we're going to succeed in our country unless we have committed family life, a child-centered family system, is hard to imagine," Bush said. "Irrespective of the Supreme Court ruling, because they're going to decide whatever they decide, and I don't know what they're going to do, we need to be stalwart supporters of traditional marriage." In previous interviews, Bush has argued that same-sex marriage is something best left to the states to decide. On Sunday, however, he spoke about the issue in much more urgent and moralistic terms. Quote, "If we want to create a right-to-rise society where people, particularly children born in poverty, if we want to have them have a chance, we should be a core American value," Bush said. "We have to restore committed, loving family life with a mom and a dad, loving their children with their heart and soul," unquote. In the wake of the nationwide controversy over so-called religious freedom laws that critics argue allow for discrimination against same-sex couples, Bush was asked whether he thought it acceptable for business owners to refuse to provide services for a gay wedding. "Yeah, absolutely," Bush said, "if it's based on a religious belief. The best example is the florist in Washington State who may lose her business because of this and has lost a lot because of the cost of all of this. She had a regular customer who came in and she would provide flowers to him, and he was going to marry his significant other, asked her to participate as a friend in the wedding to help organize it, and she thought about it and said, 'Look, I love you. You're my friend, but I can't participate. It goes against my conscience,'" unquote. In the case Bush referenced, a Superior Court judge in Washington ruled in February that Baptist florist Baronel Stutzman had violated the state's anti-discrimination and consumer protection laws by citing her religious beliefs as her reason for not providing floral arrangements for a same-sex wedding. Yeah, it just goes to show you the kind of world we live in these days, when you can't even refuse to provide flowers just based on your religious views. You have to go and get a lawyer and provide like 200,000 pages of paperwork just for them to even sit down and mull it over, they say. In fact, at that Eagle Forum conference, didn't I hear one speaker, I think it was Brad Dacus, said that in Canada particularly, you can't even quote Romans chapter 1 because they consider it hate speech there.
Yep. Certainly right about that, Corey. And no wonder we have the likes of our public school systems here in the U.S. banning Bible reading inside the classroom, because they...
You see why the number of shootings have gone up? It's because the number of problems going up in schools isn't because of just the ones that become corrupted. It's because we have allowed ourselves to essentially corkscrew religion out of our public schools, and any references to God are pretty much banned. And when you do that, you just let in, you just open up Pandora's box. That's what.
Well, I would disagree with you on the part that not religion is being out of schools, but certain religion is being taken out and certain religion is being allowed in.
That's what I meant to say.
Islamic likeliness of prayer rooms being put inside public schools and Islamic children getting exceptions to go and get to pray and read their Quran, but Christian children not being able to do that. I wish there would be some sort of Christian lawyer out there or any law firm out there who has the gall to go over and sue the likes of the public school system and the federal government.
The Department of Education specifically.
Exactly. Exactly my point, and say,
yeah, you said it better than I can.
This is wrong. Double standard here. You're allowing these Islamic people to be able to pray and be able to read their Qurans in schools, yet Christian children are not able to do it. That's wrong to me. You have a double standard for these people. These Democrats always love to say how we're limiting these Islamic people's free speech. Well, what about our free speech? You're limited our free speech. Always your double standard, you hypocritical liberal beeps, as I like to say. On that note, before I go into a little tirade over the liberal communist government that we have control in the likes of the White House and even some Republicans within the Republican-controlled House and Senate, we'll send it over to Corey Evan. He'll close out tonight's Global Socialism segment.
So, when will the world learn to respect the rights of the family? When will the public schools learn to balance the standards and their morals? And did I leave my food out in the rain last week? I think I did. Stay tuned for developments in our continuing battle against global socialism.
And now it's time for Lawsuits Across America. The cases are real. All rise for the Honorable Corey Evan.
Thank you, as always, Pat Hahn. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated and come to order. Lawsuits Across America is now in session. The first time docket is coming to us from Fox News. Four passengers on the Amtrak train that derailed last week in Philadelphia filed a federal suit on Monday, citing serious and disabling injuries. According to Reuters, the lawsuit against the U.S. Rail Service filed in Philly appeared to be the first by non-employee passengers since the May 12th crash that killed 8 and injured more than 200. On Friday, an Amtrak employee filed the first lawsuit asking for $150,000 in damages or more. The passengers who filed the lawsuit include two cousins from Spain.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, I apologize. We seem to have lost Corey Evan in the transit there. Tonight's Lawsuits Across America. So while we try to get a connection back there with Corey Evan, we'll go ahead and do a little entertainment story here. Unless we get Corey Evan back here, which we just did. And let's go ahead, join him back already in progress with tonight's Lawsuits Across America. Corey?
Yerk. That just goes to show you the hackers have gotten to me now. Anyway, the news of the lawsuit came as Amtrak trains began rolling again early today, the first since the derailment. Amtrak resumed service with a 5:30 a.m. southbound train leaving New York. The first northbound train scheduled to leave at 5:53 was delayed and pulled out at 6:07. Both trains arrived at their destinations about 30 minutes behind schedule. Better late than dead, I always say, but I'm sure one or two people will disagree. To you, I say, which would you rather have, your life or your schedule? I'll rephrase that in the future and I'll say it better. But at any rate, the U.S. Supreme Court on Monday, according to the document, declined to hear an appeal seeking to permanently block a secret probe into Governor Scott Walker's 2012 recall campaign and its dealings with allied groups, ending one line of attacks by subjects of the investigation. This according to the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel. There we are. The high-profile probe remains stalled, however, because of a separate decision last year by a Wisconsin judge that's now being reviewed as a part of a trio of cases before the Wisconsin Supreme Court. The state's high court is expected to decide the cases this summer, which will determine whether the investigation can be revived or must be abandoned for good. The ruling's likely to come just as the Republican governor launches an expected presidential campaign, yet another one to throw his hat into the ring and get himself run over. The U.S. Supreme Court passed on taking the case without any comment, as its usual practice. Its decision leaves in place an appeals court ruling that dismissed the lawsuit. Prosecutors launched their John Doe probe in August 2012 in Milwaukee County and last year expanded it to four others. They were looking at whether Walker's campaign illegally collaborated with ostensibly independent groups such as the Wisconsin Club for Growth. Yeah, define growth these days, ladies and gentlemen. And I got one more from Fox News, and this time it involves kids on the bus. If it'll go. Forgive me, sometimes the satellite can affect.
Wee, 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 wee.
Yeah, just like Maxwell, right? Anyway, the parents of an 8-year-old girl with Down syndrome are suing the Yakima, Washington School District. Oh, dear. My aunt and uncle live up there. So, Aunt Susan, Uncle Roy, this is for you. Anyway, they're suing the local district there for allegedly failing to stop a disabled 5th-grade boy from repeatedly sexually and physically abusing the girl, while the two rode a school bus. The suit was filed by the Tamaki Law Offices in Yakima and alleges the girl was repeatedly assaulted from September 2013 until the following March. The assaults allegedly ranged in duration from several minutes to 15 minutes each and were often filmed by a school bus camera. The suit alleges both the bus driver and the school district were negligent and failed to supervise its students properly. According to the suit, the abuse, which occurred on a special needs bus, included punching, pinching, scratching, hitting, slapping, and multiple sexual assaults. The abuse was reported on March 27th when the girl arrived home with bruises and deep scratches on her face. The family notified the school, who allegedly discovered the abuse had been happening for months. The bus driver was put on leave, and the suspected perpetrator, an 11-year-old boy who has severe disabilities, was immediately expelled. Other children allegedly noted the abuse documents show and told the boy to stop, but he usually ignored or couldn't understand their requests. The lawsuit seeks an unknown amount in damages. Oh, boy. To know that this went on for months before they did something about it, yeah, that is definitely negligent in my book. Isn't it in yours, Jay?
Oh, certainly right. Worse than a pig screaming, wee, hanging off the end of a school bus, wee.
Yes, and Maxwell? Don't forget to change out that busted taillight. Anyway, that is case dismissed for your Monday Lawsuits Across America.
All right, Corey Evan with tonight's Lawsuits Across America. Pigs dismissed as well, out of the pig pen inside the courtroom today as well.
Yeah, before Jay fries them on the stove.
Oh. Yeah, you must have smelled that ham I was cooking over the weekend that I have in the fridge. My goodness, Corey Evan, not only is the judge for Lawsuits Across America. He has an impeccable mind and smell and a good nose that he can smell a ham cooking in my house all the way up from Los Angeles down to San Diego. Ladies and gentlemen, that is a talent that no one has.
Yeah, I'm just jonesing for a good bacon sandwich.
Ooh, wow. See, ladies and gentlemen, he's talking about going to Jack in the Box after the show, and he didn't even invite me. Wow.
Mm. All right. One of these times we'll meet up.
Speaking of the entertainment, it's time for entertainment, all jokes aside. 2 years ago, Ronnie Brower weighed a staggering 675 pounds. Oh, wait, is there supposed to be a theme in here? Yes, there is. Master Computer, can we have that little entertainment theme? Thank you. All right, now we're in business. I don't usually do this, but this is fun. It's going to be fun. Ronnie Brower weighed a staggering 675 pounds, and his doctor told him if he didn't make some drastic changes to his life, he would be dead in 10 years. But now, thanks to hard work, harder workouts, a dedicated teacher, and some inspiration from a certain singer, Ronnie has dropped down to 250 pounds. Who's this singer, you might ask? Well, it's Taylor Swift. Ronnie's friend and former teacher, John Profernio, promised Ronnie they would take him to see Taylor Swift perform after he lost 400 pounds. Ronnie listened to Taylor Swift throughout his weight loss, and now, to celebrate reaching his milestone, he will see her perform live. He told me in his darkest days he would often listen to Taylor, and it was the message in her music and the time that gave him some source of joy and happiness and kept him buying into life, Raphael told the Daily Dot. Now that Ronnie has met his weight loss goal, Joe has another goal, to have Ronnie meet the pop icon herself. Joe posted a video chronicling Ronnie's transformation, sent it to Taylor Swift, tunes that inspired Ronnie through his weight loss journey. show asked the pop star if she will meet Ronnie when the pair attended her concert in June. Taylor Swift fans have been tweeting the video across the internet using the hashtag #RonSwiftWeightLoss. We hope that Ronnie gets the chance to meet her. And Corey, I would agree. But we certainly hope that Ronnie does get the likes of meeting the likes of Taylor Swift. Not only his favorite singer, but your favorite singer as well.
Yeah, she's not too bad, I'll say that much. And she dominated the Billboard Music Awards with 8 wins, including Top Artist and Top Billboard 200 Album for 1989 and Top Female Artist. And she went on to say, "Oh, this is such a good night." You should have said, "It feels like one of those nights." You know, quote one of your own songs, but I digress. Back to the story.
It's a Ronnie night. That's what you should have said. It's a Ronnie night.
True. She owned the night with wins for Top Hot 100 Artists and the fan-voted Artist Achievement Award. She kissed her rumored boyfriend Calvin Harris on the cheek and gave him a hug at the MGM Grand Garden Arena in Las Vegas. Swift, who sat next to the DJ producer-singer, kicked off the awards by debuting her action-filled music video for Bad Blood, which stars Selena Gomez and Lena Dunham, and showcases Swift as a fighting vixen. Oh, that's going to be interesting. Yes, I know. And I'll let you watch the video. I won't go into description about it because I will fumble it, I assure you. Because you're better off watching the video to understand exactly. Yes, and due to time, we will move on to the box office numbers, which I believe Mad Max Fury Road was in the top 3. It just needs a moment, as always. Come on, you. Get back to work! Tomorrowland is... No, wait. Here's the box office numbers. Pitch Perfect was number 1 with $69.2 million. Mad Max Fury Road, disappointed, coming in second place with $45.4 million. And Avengers Age of Ultron held on at number 3 with $38.9 million. So there you are. Entertainment Report, and Taylor Swift is the scene stealer this time around. So who will steal the scene tomorrow? You'll find out. Till then, I'm Corey Evan.
Thank you very much, Corey. Corey Evan with the Entertainment Report. And not often I do the entertainment part of the Entertainment Report on this program, but that little story with Ronnie, inspirational. I wish him the best of luck, because when you lose that amount of weight and you try to keep that weight loss, that is the most difficult thing you can do in your life, to keep that weight off and keep yourself in shape. It is always...
Yes, and it's definitely got me... barely able to finish my pizza and soda.
Oh, see? It inspires you to get off junk food. See? Everybody gets inspired by this guy, Ronnie. Great job, Ronnie. Great job. All right, on that note, ladies and gentlemen, that is the Evan Miller Report for this Monday, May the 18th, 2015. Coming next before the Exceptional Conservative Show at the top of the hour, it's the BBC weather forecast from their Met Office with Steve DeVos. Steve, take it away for tonight's weather.
Cold fronts across the Midwest during the weekend brought a line of thunderstorms with tornadoes being reported. Now, this first active cold front continuing its journey eastwards, affecting the upper Mississippi Valley and the Tennessee Valley with further thunderstorms and a risk of large hail and tornadoes. The whole system continuing to move towards the eastern seaboard, generally weakening as it does so. Meanwhile, across the west, another area of low pressure sending an active weather front into the Midwest will generate another round of severe storms, potentially with large hail and with tornadoes, so another system to watch out for. Across British Columbia and the Pacific Northwest, here an area of low pressure which is continuing to move inland will allow for some sunshine to move into its place. Variable amounts of cloud during the course of Tuesday. Some heavy rain, though, across the Rockies, some snow falling over the higher peaks. But for California and towards the Great Basin, the far southwest, it's set to stay fair with lots of sunshine. So pretty decent outlook, I think, for the West Coast Wednesday into Thursday. A lot of dry weather. Nice spells of sunshine for Vancouver both Wednesday and Thursday. Now, across the east, we continue to see that weather front pushing out towards the eastern seaboard. Potentially some embedded thunderstorms in this system as it continues to move eastwards. And the southeast corner remaining quite warm and humid. Risk of some thunderstorms breaking out ahead of that front through central southern Florida. So the outlook then, Wednesday into Thursday across the east. The showers eventually easing away with some sunshine moving.
Conservative media done right. You're listening to the SHR Media Network.